try to help people see the future that you're imagining when you're building the products that you and the Meta team are building. What are you imagining mm-hmm. this looks like in the future? How are you imagining people use this? Sure. All of that.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right.
Awesome. So I'd love to start with these.
Let's do it. 10 years of work right there.
I got to demo them a little bit earlier today. Oh, I heard someone on your team call these the real life Tony Stark glasses.
We're getting there.
But I'd love to just hear in your voice, what are these?
Well, these are the first full holographic augmented reality glasses, I think, that exist in the world. We've made, I think it's a few thousand or something, right? Very hard to make each one of these. But this is the culmination of 10 years of research and development that we've done to basically miniaturize all the computing that you need to have glasses, not a headset, but glasses that can put full holograms into the world with a wide field of view. So you can imagine sort of in the future, we'd be having a version of this conversation where, you know, maybe I or you are not even here. It's like one of us is physically here and the other one is here as kind of a full body hologram. And it's not just a video call. You can actually interact. You can do things. I mean, in the demo, we had the, you know, ping pong and games and things like that. But I mean, you can interact, you can work together, you can, you know, play poker, play chess, whatever, like the holographic cards, holographic board game. I just think it's going to be wild. It's going to remake, I think, so many different fields that we think about today, from how we work and productivity to a lot of things around science, a lot of things around education, entertainment, fun, gaming. But this is just the beginning. You know, this is the first version. It's like, it's a prototype version that we've made in order to develop the next version, which is hopefully going to be the consumer one that we sell to a lot of people.
Why build these?
Well, I think it's going to be the next major computing platform. So if you look at like the grand arc of computing over time, you've gone from like mainframes to computers that basically like live on, you know, your desk or on a tower, to phones that you have in your hand that you basically like, you know, can take with you everywhere that you want, but it's pretty unnatural, right? It takes you away from the world around you. And I think that the trend in computing is it gets more ubiquitous, it gets more natural, and it just gets more social, right? So you want to be able to interact with people in the world around you. And I think that this is probably going to be the next major platform after phones.
I'll give these to you. These are the clear ones that show all
the whole
technology.
Thing is a special edition, and this is like a really special edition. There's not a single millimeter of space. It's, you know, everything in here, from the micro projectors that basically shoot light into the waveguides, right? It's a special type of display system. I mean, these aren't normal displays like you have in a phone or a TV or computer, like the type of displays that people have been building for decades. It's a waveguide system. The projector that's shooting light basically goes into these nano etchings across the waveguide that are what catches and creates the holograms. In order to synchronize that with your where you're looking, there's eye tracking and little cameras. They illuminate your eyes. And then, of course, there's all the basic stuff that you need, all the computing, the batteries to power the whole thing, microphones, the speakers, because it needs to be able to play audio and speak with you, and the cameras and sensors to see things around you in the world. So that way, when it's placing holograms in the world, it can do that in the right place and understand where you are. So that probably is still not covering everything, because there's a lot of things that need to go into syncing up the holographic images between the two displays, because you don't just have a single display like you have in a phone or TV. You have two, and it moves around, and you know, physical things are hard and need to be synced up. There's also the radio that has to communicate with your other computing devices to do heavier computing, and the wrist-based neural interface that you probably got to try out. We kind of miniaturized all of this and fit it into you know, normal-looking pair of glasses, which is you know, when I told the team that we were going to do this 10 years ago, you know, people weren't sure if we were going to be able to. But I think, you know, not only are we going to be able to do this, but I think we're going to be able to get it cheaper and higher quality and even smaller and more stylish over time. So I think this is going to be a pretty wild future.
there are so many versions of trying to get at a similar idea of digital objects in physical space. I'm thinking of, for example, glasses that have heads-up displays mm-hmm. where it's headlocked and it's moving with my yep. eyes. Glasses that are really creating digital objects in physical space that don't move as mm-hmm. I move. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of these. I'm also thinking of the Snapchat spectacles that they just announced. Then, on the other hand, there are headsets like the Quest and mm-hmm. also like the Apple Vision Pro that seem to fall into a different category. I'm curious how you would organize this landscape for people yeah. and how you think about people using these tools in their real lives in the near future.
Yeah, so when we were getting started on this about 10 years ago, I thought that something like this was going to be the ultimate product for everyone, right? You get to normal looking pair of glasses, and we'll continue improving that, that can have full holographic images.
Yeah.
I think it's super powerful, and it is sort of the science fiction future that I think we all hope to get to. On the journey, we took a few other approaches as well to help us develop towards that, including building glasses that don't have displays, to try to learn, just take a stylish pair of glasses today and put as much technology into it as you can, but really focus on the form factor. And that's the Ray-Ban Meta glasses, and it's doing really well. And initially, we thought that that was sort of intro product for us to learn how to build this. But one of the things that's clear now is you're going to be able to make that product a lot more affordable than this, probably permanently. So I actually think that there are going to be a bunch of different of these paths that we've taken are going to be kind of permanent product lines that people will choose. I think you'll see displayless glasses like the Ray-Ban Metas continue to get better and better. Great for AI. No display, but you can talk to it. It can talk back. I think that there's going to be something in between these that's basically a heads-up display. So it's not a 70-degree field of view. Maybe it's a 20-degree or 30-degree field of view. So that's not going to be what you want for putting kind of a full hologram of a person or interacting with the world around you. But it's going to be great for, you know, when you're talking to AI, not just having voice, but also being able to see what it's saying.
Yeah. Right?
Or being able to text someone with your wrist-based neural interface and then have their text show up rather than having it read to you, which is, it's, we read faster than we can listen. Or getting directions, right? Or just being able to search for information and get all that. So there's a lot of value for a heads-up display. That will be somewhat more expensive than the displayless glasses, but somewhat cheaper than this. Then I think you're going to get this. It's going to be probably the most premium and expensive of the glasses products, but hopefully still something that, you know, like a computer, is generally accessible to most people in the world. But I think that there are going to be all of those, and I think people will like them. I also think that the headsets that people are using around mixed reality will continue to be a thing too, because no matter how good we get at miniaturizing the tech for this, you're just going to be able to fit more compute into a full headset. You know, fundamentally, our mission is not, you know, build something that is advanced and only a few people can use. We want to take it, you know, the last mile and do all the innovation to get it to everyone. We, you know, just shipped or announced Quest 3S, the new mixed reality headset. We basically are delivering high-quality mixed reality for $299. I was really proud last year when we delivered Quest 3, the first kind of really high-quality, high resolution, color, mixed reality device for $500, right? It was like, it's like a fraction of the cost of what the competitors are doing. And I think it's actually higher quality in a lot of ways. And now we've just doubled down on that. So I think that they're all actually going to end up being important long-term product lines. Displayless, heads-up display, full holographic AR, full headsets. I think that they're all going to be important.
Yeah.